is John Colo with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for him here in Northern California at the house of Dr. Jeff Pierce and his amazing wife and their family that live here on this little property. And Jeff is a medical doctor, and this medical doctor will prescribe to you to grow your own food, and more importantly than just growing your own food, he wants you to eat it too. So he is a family licensed family physician and also into lifestyle medicine. So here's the thing, if you guys are looking for a new lifestyle coach and you're in certain states that he is licensed in, he could do telehealth and help you out and get you flying straight to maybe even give you guys some gardening tips at a long time, because him and his wife are both gardeners, but also more importantly, he's into having the optimal health through your own personal pharmacy, not the pharmacy with a PH, but a pharmacy with an F, a pharmacy which is based around fruits and vegetables and other plants that you guys could grow and eat. The big problem in America today, in my opinion, is that most people eat too much processed foods and animal foods in excess, and they're not eating enough whole plant foods, and that's what Dr. Jeff Pierce is all about. So I'm so glad to show you guys his property where he is actually doing it for real. He's just not one of those doctors that's going to tell you to do these things and then not do it behind the scenes. I've checked him out. I've seen his stuff. He grows probably more varieties than I do that I'm embarrassed to say. And he grows all kinds of amazing foods that I want you guys to incorporate into your diet. He also does it in many different ways. So if you guys don't have a property, even if you have a balcony in your apartment, he grows ways that you guys could do in your apartment. If you have a property with neighbors, he has ways to use the side of his yard to grow trees and to grow more fruits and different vegetables in pots. And if you only have a sidewalk or, you know, like a concrete slab in your backyard, he's basically dug up his slab so that he can plant fruit trees and concrete sod and all kinds of cool stuff. He grows so many different cool kinds of plants in all these different ways. I can't show you everything here today, but what I hope to share with you guys are some of the most nutritious plants that you guys should grow that could be quite easy to grow, that you don't have to manage too much, but also more importantly, plants and vegetables and fruits that will fight disease for you guys. And of course, the big part of this episode for me is interviewing Dr. Jeff, where he's gonna share his tips and tricks with you guys so that you guys can get healthier, and maybe even potentially with his help, get off your medications if you are on things like blood pressure medications, or even if you have type 2 diabetes. I'm sure Dr. Jeff could help you resolve those issues personally, but we'll have to talk to him about that because he's the doctor and I'm just the neophyte here showing you guys his garden. So let's come along for the journey. So the first shot is in Dr. Jeff's front yard, where he has just a lot of common landscaping, so you would never really know that built into this front yard that looks really cool. It's all wood chips, so that's very important to build your soil, because the soil is your foundation of your plant's health. So more importantly, akin to the soil in your yard for your plant's health, our microbiome is super important for our health. So like plants and people kind of like have a nice synergy that I know about, but it's super important to eat many different kinds of foods. I mean, one of the things that he's grown here are persimmons. I love persimmons. Now they are a sweet fruit. They're a bit higher in calories than most other fruits, but they're a very good source of beta carotene because they are so orange. I want you guys to eat really colorful foods. Another fruit that he's growing that's actually really good for your microbiome is the pomegranates here. So he has one pomegranate tree right here and then another one back there. But pomegranates can be helpful with helping get some good bacteria in your gut known as acromantia. And these are very important little guys, and it's because of the polyphenols in the pomegranates that feed your acromantia and build your health personally. But I'm sure at the same time, all the trees will always help the soil health because it encourages mycorrhiza in the soil, and as well as having the wood chips on the ground will help build the soil health. And when you grow the plants and eat them, it'll build your health as well. The next thing I wanna do is I wanna take you guys to the backyard to show you guys all the cool vegetables that Dr. Jeff is growing. All right, so now I wanna show you guys actually going into the backyard, and actually this is technically a driveway back to the garage in the back that was kind of converted into like a play space back there for his kids and arts and crafts or some other stuff, plus a little greenhouse. And so you shouldn't really even be in a plant here, but how does Dr. Jeff grow on a concrete pad that was literally a driveway? Well, let's go into his backyard and check it out. And you can see, this is the driveway here, but right, it's all greenery all around because he has all these pots, and these pots, I'm like, wow, where'd he get these pots? They look really decorative. He actually painted these pots so his wife wouldn't get mad at him for using plastic pots. And to me, I like walk back here like, wow, those are pretty. I'm like, who made those? He's like, I made them. I'm like, whoa, you're not only a doctor, but you're an artist too. So anyways, you guys could grow in pots like this, even if you don't have, you know, a yard to grow in. If you just on a, you know, a flat concrete pad, or if you have only space on your patio, you should always try to grow at least a little bit of your own food. So in all these pots that are nice and painted, he has so many different kinds of things growing. I mean, here's like a sugar snap peas, here's strawberries, that's what I'm eating today for my lunch. Here's onions, here's sweet potatoes. He's got things like collard greens and kohlrabi and like different kinds of, I think maybe horseradish over there, red dandelion, so many different things he's growing in pots. In addition, he also built a raised bed here on top of the concrete. So, I mean, if you have a place to do that, you can just build a raised bed over the concrete. It does not need to be over the open ground. I mean, of course, I would always encourage you guys to have it over ground, open ground, if ever possible, because now you get the microbial action from the ground into your raised bed. But you could always introduce, you know, some of the native creatures and microbes from your ground into your raised bed. And as you guys can see, he's got tomatoes and different kinds of things, including my favorite purple tree collards growing back there. He's also got things in little containers. So, I mean, he's experimenting. I mean, the cool thing about Dr. Jeff is he's experimenting with many different kinds of plants that shouldn't necessarily grow here in this area. This is actually a mango that he's trying to grow, and he protects it in the winter because it's definitely not going to handle the frost they get here. A curry tree for the spice. Of course, the okra. And the okra he's growing is a special okra. I would grow this as my primary okra. It's actually the red okra, so it actually has red or purple pigments in the plants. And I have a video on it, actually, why every gardener should grow purple foods. And Dr. Jeff is fully aware of this because of the anthocyanin content. It's these purple foods that have been shown by science to have extra health benefits over just the vegetables alone because of these anthocyanins. And the other thing is that these anthocyanins are not in there for us to benefit when we eat them. It also benefits the plants because the plants create the anthocyanins so that it can be more resistant to bugs, disease, and stress. Another cool thing about Dr. Jeff is that he's planted many different kinds of trees. He just doesn't have only figs or only this or only that. He has a wider selection of fruit trees than I've seen. He has like pawpaws, he has mulberries, he has jujubes, he has citrus, he has apples, he has peaches. I mean, I could probably just go on and on. But anyways, this is like a Satsuma mandarin, and you know, these guys will produce a fruit that's very high in vitamin C, everybody. Yeah, vitamin C, it's so good for us. Well, yes, vitamin C is quite healthy. I encourage you guys to eat vitamin C on a regular basis, you know, throughout your day, not just at like one meal where you drink orange juice in the morning and then you don't have vitamin C for the rest of the day. Vitamin C is used up very quickly in our body, so I like to have it throughout the day. You know, my evening meal might be like some fruit with some vitamin C. I mean, of course, leafy greens have vitamin C, but the cool thing I want to point out here is besides just the vitamin C content in the oranges, and actually if you guys want to grow the healthiest citrus, it is actually the kumquats. Now, why would kumquats be healthier than satsumas or oranges? It's because you eat the peel, and actually most of the nutrients in the citrus is it actually in the peel, not in the fruit itself in the middle. Anyways, this is his concrete pad, and what he's done, if you guys look closely here, he's literally cut out like a square out of the concrete pad so he could basically plant this tree into the soil down below it. So that is one cool technique that you can do if, you, of course, you own your own place. Don't just be cutting up concrete pads if you're renting. So another thing besides just the fruits and the vegetables that are grown here, they also have, they're keeping the bees. And the bees, they're creating a habitat for the bees. I mean, the bees are in jeopardy because of all the craziness going on in the world, due to the different changes in the weather, due to the different RF frequencies around, and all the different Roundup and chemicals and pesticides being sprayed. So Dr. Jeff and his wife are keeping the bees. That'll not only help them increase population, but also keep the biodiversity of other species on the planet alive, which is also very important for our survival. Have you guys ever wondered the best water to use to water your garden? Well, no, it's not out of the pipe of the municipal city water that's been chlorinated that can damage your microbes in your soil. Honestly, the best water to use to water your garden is what nature would water with it naturally. And that's what Dr. Jeff is all about, living more of a natural lifestyle and eating what we would have eaten naturally for health and to build soil health, to build our health. What's the best water? It's rainwater. And he's built his own water harvesting system with all these 50 gallon like old olive containers where they ship olives over, and he's got at least like 300 gallons of water storage right here. So when it rains, he collects the water and then he uses this water to water his garden, which is the best water to use. Of course, when the water runs out, because it doesn't rain too much in the summer here, you know, he'll use filtered tap water, which is the second best water to use. But I always want to encourage you guys to be more sustainable on the planet and collect and harvest your own water. Now, while I'm still sitting here, another thing that he does is he tries to fill in and use ground cover to cover his ground along with things like the wood chips. But the nasturtium, especially in this climate, is a perfect thing to cover your ground with. Not only will it cover the ground and protect the soil, the sun hitting the ground, the sun will now hit the nasturtium leaves, make the beautiful flowers, and most people know that you guys can eat the nasturtium flowers, which have a nice peppery flavor, but most people don't know is that you could also eat the nasturtium leaves. You could pick a few of these leaves and add them to your salad. They're even more peppery than the flowers, so don't add too many. So another element that I want you guys to focus on as gardeners is to grow your own herb. No, wait, I mean herbs, not herb. You should grow some herbs. Herbs have very aromatic scents. This happens to be rosemary. He also has some oregano and other herbs growing around, mixed into the landscaping here. Herbs are very important sources of different kinds of aromatics and essential oils, and they have properties that are antioxidant and probably even anti-cancer for us. One of my common things that I do is every day I will drink some rosemary juice, not straight, of course, it's too strong. I basically make a mixture of turmeric, ginger, rosemary with oregano, and also mix in clove, dried cloves, and this last batch had cinnamon in there and black pepper, as my immune boosting shot every single day. The cool thing I learned about rosemary is that you want to harvest it at different places on the plant. There are studies that show like the tips have different phytonutrients than the more mature like stems that are more woody, and like every different part has different levels of these different nutrients as the plant's going through its growth cycle. So I try to harvest some of the young stuff, some of the more mature stuff, and mix that in very small amounts, because a little bit of rosemary is good, but according to some of the studies, too much is not a good thing. So you guys always want to mediate and balance all these different plant foods that you guys are eating. Not eat too much, but definitely not eat too little either. Another amazing vegetable that Dr. Jeff is growing are the artichokes, and here's one that actually dried up, and he told me that he had a bumper crop of artichokes, so many that he couldn't even eat them all, and he let some go to flower, and here's one that just kind of dried up. I would always harvest all my artichokes, because artichokes, honestly, are one of my favorite foods. They're very high in antioxidants, according to some of the science I've seen out there, even if they're processed and canned. Of course, freshest is always best, this is what I say. And here's an artichoke. And the cool thing about artichokes, depending on where you live, this is a perennial vegetable. And to me, perennial vegetables are even more valuable than common vegetables, because perennial vegetables, you literally plant it just once. You take care of it, you keep it alive, and it comes back year after year. So literally you plant an artichoke plant once, provided you're in the right climate. Every year you'll get artichokes like in the spring, and depending on some places, you might get artichokes two times a year, which is just amazing. They're amazing food to eat. When you grow them yourself, you can choose to harvest them when they're a little bit younger. When they're a little bit younger, you could probably eat the whole thing. When they get a little bit more mature, then I like to eat like the center hearts and maybe a few of the outside, leaves. And when they get more mature, then, they're not as fun to me to eat. So I really like them when they're a lot younger than older. And of course, when you guys grow your own food, you are in control of what part of the plant you want to harvest. Like I talked about the rosemary, or you could harvest it at the stage you want. Of course, when growing fruits, you could harvest your fruits when they're at their peak ripeness and not early, like most grocery stores or markets will sell you. So another very important vegetable I want you guys to grow that cultures around the world have literally subsisted on are beans. And Dr. Jeff is growing some of the most nutritious beans on the planet, based on my opinion. And it's these little purple string beans. So these purple string beans, not only are there beans, you could eat these raw when they're young. Nice and crisp. We also have the purple anthocyanins. If you guys let these grow older and dry out like he's done here in the back, actually in the back here, he has a different kind of bean. I think these are, you got a different kind of bean. Anyways, he also has purple runner beans, which are perennial bean to eat. Beans are a very good source of nutrients, as well as beneficial fiber and resistant starch, which are really healthy for us to eat, especially for our microbiome. And to be healthy, you need to have a good microbiome. And to feed your microbiome, you don't want to eat processed foods, junk foods, fast foods, or even animal foods. They don't really optimally feed your microbiome, but guess what? Beans will. And so will actually the sweet potatoes that I showed you guys a bit earlier that he grows. And of course, the purple foods. All right, now we're in the back 40, literally, of Jeff's place, and he has actually an in-ground raised bed garden, all wood chipped and looking really natural. And this is his garden with a lot of his different leafy greens. Of course, he had some in the pots up front, but these are looking a lot better than some of those pots in the front here. He, of course, has things like Swiss chard and different kind of beets and different kind of brassica family plants. Also some Chinese cabbage and some Brussels sprouts. But, you know, here's the thing. Greens are at the base of the food pyramid of all the different herbivores on the planet. They eat greens. I mean, cows should be eating greens, which is grass, but unfortunately most of them are being fed GMO corn and soy, which I wouldn't consider healthy. But we also should be eating plenty of greens in our diet. I mean, greens makes the basis of my diet. I eat a vegetable-based diet, and I want to encourage you guys also to eat a vegetable-based diet. You want to eat more leafy green vegetables than anything else. My goal every day is to eat 2 pounds of leafy greens. Today I've already done that because I drank them in a green juice that I made this morning. And I've already drank, probably about 48 ounces of green juice, which is basically in 1 cup of juice, which is 8 ounces, that's like 1 pound. So I've probably already eaten like 5 pounds of vegetables this morning. And I want you guys to eat more greens, however you guys got to do them, whether you want to juice them, whether you guys want to vacuum blend them. You know, I have a different YouTube channel, Discount Juices, where I share all the appliances so that you can optimally process your greens and damage them the least and maintain the most amount of phytonutrients and vitamins and minerals in there. If you guys want to learn about the best equipment to use, even if you got to eat them raw, make a salad. A salad's the easiest way because you can just pick them. I mean, you could just pick a green. I mean, we're going to snack on some greens right here. You could pick it. Let me tell you guys, man, just eating greens fresh like this is like the best thing in the world. Most people like buy greens in the grocery store and they taste horrible because they've been picked, hydro-cooled, packed, and like sitting around. This is like fresh life force energy. Nothing better than fresh greens. Even if you got to cook your greens, if you want to cook your greens, I have videos on that too, how to cook your greens in an Instant Pot, which is the best way, the healthiest way to cook your greens. I'll put a link down below to that video if I remember. But yeah, I really want you guys to make greens a big part of your diet and increase the amount of leafy greens you grow. And the good thing is, greens can be so expensive when you buy them at the grocery store, if you're buying organic especially. But when you grow them yourself, they are the easy things to grow. I mean, if you got to grow a tomato plant, you got to grow the tomato plant. It's got to make all the greens. And if you get lucky, it gets the flowers. And if it gets the flowers, get pollinated, then it makes the tomatoes. But the greens, you grow them, it grow the leaves. You just eat the leaves. Super simple, super easy, and everybody could do it. So Dr. Jeff is growing one of the most nutritious grapes in the entire planet. It's these grapes right here. These are purple grapes. And luckily, these are purple wine grapes. I don't know what variety they are. But purple grapes, I want you guys to incorporate some purple grapes into your diet, whether you guys got to grow them yourself or whether you have to buy them. Unfortunately, when you buy the grapes at the grocery store, even if they're purple, once again, those purple anthocyanins that I love so much, right, you're getting seedless grapes, which are totally sad because you are missing out on nutrition because there's so much nutrition in the grape seeds. There's pycnogenol, they say, in the grape seeds. I mean, they used to sell these supplements with pycnogenol. It's also in pine bark, the pycnogenol, but in the grape seeds, there's the pycnogenol as well as the anthocyanins and the purple. So if we spit, you can see the little grape seeds in there. I don't want you guys to spit out these seeds. Chew them up into a mush. And how I like to use them is actually I like to put the whole grapes into a vacuum blender, blend it up so I get the particle size ground down, so a lot of the nutrients get dispersed into the liquid, put it through a nut milk bag, and squeeze out the juice. So now I have my own grape juice with the benefits of the seeds. Maybe that's why wine is so good, because they basically they're taking grapes with the seeds and all, because wine grapes have seeds, so they have a high antioxidant content. But then they do a step that's unnecessary, in my opinion, is they ferment it. And now they're creating some potential toxins in the alcohol, you know, a little bit, but now you're getting the benefits of the wine. That's why they say wine is so good. Well, if wine's so good, guess what? The grape juice made with wine grapes is even better, and that's what I want you guys to consume. Of course, one of the keys to having a healthy garden is having a compost pile and composting all your food waste and all your yard clippings and scraps. This way you can build up your soil by adding organic matter that's being created on site with your local microbial community. So you're working with your local microbial communities. In addition, this is open on the bottom, so worms and other creatures are getting in here and basically eating up the different nutrients and pooping out their own nutrients. So that's why I like worm casting so much. Right now in my compost piles, I have these black soldier flies that are even more efficient eaters than even the red wigglers that people love so much, and they're pooping out their good things. And so then I'll be able to enrich my garden with my compost, and that is what Dr. Jeff is doing here as well. Another very important element to your garden's health as well as your health is creating a diversity and growing a diversity of plants. Most people might just grow tomatoes or only grow peppers or only grow their lettuce every winter time, but I want you, like Dr. Jeff is doing here. He grows so many different things. I mean, I'm like, oh, there's comfrey, there's rhubarb, there's this, there's that. He has all kinds of crazy things. And here's one that I experimented with years ago. It's a tamarillo tree. It's from South America, and actually it's impressive. He grew that from seed, which I can't say I ever did. And it's quite tall, and he's got a couple fruits on there. So, you know, it's related to the tomato. It's like known as a tree tomato. I don't know what nutrients are in it, but it's actually kind of red, so that's probably some anthocyanin benefits in there. They're really a unique fruit, and I love that fruit because, like, I planted it outside my office at my house, and in the Christmas time, it'd be, like, so cold out, it would defoliate, and I'd have all the little fruits hanging at the winter time, and I remember just looking out that, and it just looked like Christmas tree ornaments hanging, and but then, of course, I lost the tree because it was too cold, but I still got to eat all the fruits, and I had some really bumper harvests back in the day. The other thing he's actually put in a greenhouse, this is a little carport area that he converted into a greenhouse, and I'll take you guys in there and show you guys two amazing plants he's growing inside his little greenhouse. So now we're inside the little greenhouse Dr. Jeff has made, and inside here it's a different microclimate than outside, because in the wintertime this day is warmer than the outside. In addition, it's a lot more humid inside here because it's all enclosed, and this allows him to grow more things than he could otherwise. I want you guys to consider microclimates when you guys are growing different kinds of plants. In some areas of your yard, it might be really blowy and windy and get really cold. In some areas, it might get full sun. In some areas, it can be full shade, like on the other side of this wall here, which is a little alleyway. But there are still plenty of things you guys can grow. You just gotta have the right microclimate. And by putting in a greenhouse, it gives you an expansive microclimate, because now you can grow things that you probably couldn't otherwise, like this guy right here. This is known as the Java Takaba, which is basically known as a purple grape tree because they look like grapes. They grow on the little trunks here. He hasn't gotten one yet, but this plant is looking amazing because normally I would see trees like this only in like South Florida. So it's amazing to see one here in Northern California. And I was like, wow, you're keeping that thing alive. I would probably, the next thing I would grow inside here is miracle fruits or miracle berries, which would probably do really well here if he's able to do this. But miracle berries are not quite as cold tolerant as the Java Takaba. The Java Takaba could handle a little bit more cold than like a miracle fruit would. Now another thing he's growing, of course he's got the bananas in here, but he's got these guys, and this is one of my favorites. This is Moringa. Moringa is also another tropical fruit tree. Well, it has it creates the drumsticks that are completely edible. You can eat the seeds, which is also good for cleaning water out, but for me, the Moringa is so beneficial because of its leaves. There are isothiocyanates in the leaves. This is a very powerful anti-cancer food. And I don't know if it's going to stay warm up in here, but in the wintertime, because it might defoliate, but it should stay alive and come back next springtime. But Moringa is literally a food of the future. It's like so much more nutritious than many common vegetables today, plus has those anti-cancer benefits. Post a link down below on how I recommend you guys use your moringa, and the best way to eat moringa is actually not to eat it. It's to juice it so you can break open the cell walls, get some enzymatic activity, and create more powerful disease-proofing nutrition for yourself. So the last shot I want to show you guys before we interview Dr. Jeff is these guys right here, and these are one amazing plant. I would encourage you guys to grow if you guys live in a place that gets very little frost, or maybe even other places if it doesn't get too cold in the wintertime. This is the Native American runner bean that was here in America before the white man came, that of Native Americans would grow and eat. They're very decorative. The beans themselves, of course, the beans can be eaten, and there's a bunch of dried out here, so let's go ahead and harvest the dried out one, show you guys what they look like. When they dry out, they're pretty much like this, and we can crack them open and look at these nice colors in there. I mean, these are really pretty. They got the purple and the nice black color, the beneficial fiber. Of course, he's got the green ones that are still not quite dry enough to harvest and eat and turn into like something with a bean dish that you would cook up. Of course, when these guys are younger, you could eat them when they're really young and baby, you could eat them as green beans. And I really like these guys because it's a bean you plant once, and provided you take care of and manage the soil and keep the root zone warm in this winter time, it's gonna come back for you year after year to provide you guys the benefits of the beans, which in their own right are a very powerful disease-fighting plant and should also make the base of your diet if you're gonna eat a plant-based diet. So the next thing I'm gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and interview Dr. Jeff and get his ideas on why he started growing food here on his property 7 years ago, why he prescribes the people to grow their own food, and more importantly, eat the plant foods, and maybe how he can even help you, depending on where you live, if you need a medical provider to do telehealth with. So now I have the pleasure of interviewing Dr. Jeff Pierce, who I got to show you guys his amazing home. So thanks, Jeff, for taking the time to show me your amazing place. But Dr. Jeff Pierce is a family medical doctor and also into lifestyle medicine. So I'm personally glad that the whole medical community is embracing this lifestyle medicine, and they're finally realizing that a lot of the diseases that are happening to Americans today are preventable by doing a lifestyle, by changing your lifestyle and having a good, healthy lifestyle. And it's really, nobody's really teaching us how to live and eat healthfully. I mean, that's been I've had to do that on my own, but I'm glad there are now doctors like Dr. Jeff that's certified and taking boards really soon on lifestyle medicine. So Dr. Jeff, why do you grow food at your house to feed your family, and why is it so important to you that people also grow their own food and eat it too?
Yep. Well, you know, my folks told me when I was a kid to eat your vegetables, and I didn't know how important it was back then, but I do know how important it is now. And vegetables, fruits, these things that we can grow in our own garden are the most nourishing plants in the world. And they are going to help give us nutrients, vitamins, minerals, antioxidants that work on a cellular level to help prevent conditions like diabetes and heart disease and strokes and cancer. And by eating these foods, we're also not eating a lot of the fast foods and junk foods that might taste good to a lot of us, but don't do our heart or our brains any favors. And so if I can, with the help of Mother Nature, grow some of the healthiest things in the planet and feed them to myself, but more importantly, feed them to my wife and my daughter, then I'm doing a big step towards keeping us healthy and keeping us on this planet for enjoying for years to come.
Amazing. So is it true that you really prescribe growing a garden and eating plants to your patients?
I do. If you want to find a way to eat healthy, get vitamin D, get some exercise, have community, feel love, then grow your own food. And I'm tickled to death when I get to talk with a patient who says, my diabetes is turning around, I'm dropping weight, and you know what's helping? I get out in the backyard, and here, take a look at this picture of my watermelon that I grew. And how cool is it to be able to help people with their health while also using such a valuable tool to have this enjoyment with them and to keep them healthy and living for a long time.
So Dr. Jeff, how many other doctors do you know, like your colleagues, that encourage people to grow food and eat it too, and eat plants?
Well, if you had asked me when I was in medical school or in my residency training, a smaller amount of people. But nowadays, you're seeing more and more people who are realizing the benefits of growing your own food, certainly of eating your own plants as close to how they look coming out of the ground. So you don't have to put them through a bunch of processes and put them in a package and have them have a shelf life for 5 years. Really, you can grow them, you can eat them, and it's gonna keep you healthy. It's going to keep your family and friends healthy. And now you hear lots of doctors starting to talk about these benefits.
So I know a lot of you guys are watching this right now and you're thinking, my doctor never told me how to eat right or eat healthier. And they just said, go on a keto diet. So why don't other doctors out there, Dr. Jeff, encourage people to grow more plants and eat more plant foods?
Yeah, that's a real important question. And I think a lot of it goes back to our training, because we don't get a lot of information throughout our many years of study on the benefits of eating a really good diet. And we might tell our patients in passing at the end of a 8-minute visit that we have with them, oh, by the way, try to eat healthier. But if we didn't have really good education to tell them A, what to eat, and B, how to work it in a realistic way into their diet, it just falls very short at that point. I think another barrier is reimbursement, is that we have these very short visits in most medical practices, 15 minutes a person, but that includes everything in that 15 minutes. And you don't have much time to talk to them about living healthy, eating well, exercising, etc. And the fact of the matter is that we're reimbursed better to see a whole bunch of patients in a hurry to prescribe procedures than to take 30 minutes or 60 minutes and work with a patient on the right diet, the right way to move, the right way to get outside. And that's, unfortunately, these are two big barriers that are slowly changing. We're getting more education in medical schools and in residency training. We're also getting some of the payment models turning around, because what we want to do is we want to get to the root cause of the problem, not just treat symptoms with pills and putting Band-Aids on the bigger problem.
So I know a lot of my viewers right now are actually, maybe they're taking their diabetes insulin shot, or maybe they're even on like some, like my dad, you know, my parents are on blood pressure medication. So, you know, what are your thoughts on using blood pressure medication or for type 2 diabetes, taking insulin shots, when, you know, some of the studies that I've seen show that you could reverse these situations or medical conditions by changing your diet? I mean, is that true or not?
Yeah, it's true. It's true. You know, if all I was taught to do was to use pills, I would be really good at using pills. And that's what the majority of my education was up until the last couple of years. But it turns out that if you say, let's focus a lot more on putting the right things in and avoiding the bad things going into your body, that you can maybe use these pills for a little bit instead of for the rest of your life, which is what I was trained initially. Use these pills, use these injections for a little bit. For some people, you can little by little get the doses down to where you're basically on a very small dose. And for some people, you can get completely off the medications, because again, we're trying to get to the very base of the issue here, the very root cause, so that if you're sick with a lifestyle condition, often it's because of the lifestyle that you're leading. And so we need to address that and see if we can turn things around.
Wow, so I know you're gonna soon be taking your lifestyle medicine board certification, but you know, that's additional, you know, education you had to go through to be able to be board certified in this, because most doctors are simply not. I think every doctor should be certified in this personally. How much extra education, Dr. Jeff, did you have to go through you know, to be able to get this certification?
Sure. So, you know, docs in general do typically 4 years of college, 4 years of medical school, and then 3+ years of residency training, which I did. But then if you want to do some extra training in lifestyle medicine, you can, you know, get the right books, watch the right lectures. You can be a part of the American College of Lifestyle Medicine, which is a organization that is growing in popularity, and you can study the right material and sit for the boards. There's not a, you know, for me, I've been focusing on this for a few years now. It's not something that you have to be in a controlled environment to say, I'm going to this training program and I am, you know, going to do this 24/7 for 12 months or 24 months. It's learning as you go. And that's the best, I think, the sign of a good doctor. When I look at my friends, colleagues that are docs, they're always learning. And if you, especially if you're learning new techniques on how to eat the right foods, get to the basic problems, and then you can be able to not only use all the wonderful education that we all get during medical school, but in addition to that, just really expand on that and have a whole new dimension for how to help people get healthy.
Wow. So I know a lot of my viewers have different medical conditions right now, and you can't be prescribing over just a YouTube video, obviously. But I would ask you, what are some common things that people should do in their lives so that they could lead a healthier lifestyle so that they don't get disease, heart disease or cancer, all these other things in the first place? Mm-hmm. Like what kind of diet should they eat? What kind of foods? I mean, how often should they eat meat? Is meat really healthy? All these things. What would you just say as a blanket statement out to everybody that people could start doing right now?
Yep. Excellent question. And I would say, you know, you can just dip your toe into the water and add one more vegetable to your diet every day. Add one more fruit every day. And it's just that you're just testing the waters. And just that will help with modifying your risk for getting a lot of these chronic illnesses that we've been talking about. Other people want to jump all in. And I say, you know, if you're going to jump all in, I would say you're moving on to a plant-based diet. And the four big categories of foods there are vegetables, fruit, whole grains, and legumes. And the legumes are a lot of things we talked about today, beans, but also lentils, chickpeas, and split peas. And then you can also add in other things like herbs, which are super concentrated in antioxidants and other beneficial nutrients, and which you can grow yourself fairly easily. Spices, also rich in antioxidants. Mushrooms have their own categories of chemicals that can help as well.
Wonderful. And what are the foods people should avoid?
Yeah. So, you know, in America, about 55% of the diet is processed food, which means typically plant foods where a lot of the good things like fiber have been taken out and give them a longer shelf life. Another 33% of the American diet is about animal products, dairy, meat, etc. That leaves just about 10% for healthier plant foods. We need to turn that on its head. We need to live more like the people in the blue zones where 90% of their diet comes from whole plant-based foods, and that's, you know, a lot of the things that we've been talking about. So if you could say, I'm gonna fill my plate with brown rice and black beans and mango salsa and a hearty salad from greens that you grew and picked that day from your garden, you're not gonna be as hungry for you know, some of the deep fried foods or some of the other things that are adding a lot of calories but not adding a lot of nutrients.
Yeah, and that's what I would encourage you guys to do. You know, as gardeners, hopefully, and if you're not gardening yet, start growing a garden. And my goal is to, like, eat out of my garden first, you know? So, I mean, Dr. Jeff here has more Meyer lemons than he could eat probably in the whole year because he has a tree that's just so abundant. He never has to buy Meyer lemons. He never has to buy leafy greens from the store because he has so many leafy greens, you know? My goal is to, like, hit out and grow as much of this kind of food, that kind of food, so that I don't have to buy that, and then I'll just fill in with other foods. And my goal is to eat out of my garden first. So, like, you know, today I've eaten nothing except stuff out of my garden, maybe an extra organic cucumber because I don't have any cucumbers right now, in the form of juice. And so I'm eating out of my garden first, and then later on I'll have some organic strawberries from a local you know, farm and some other food. So I want you guys to focus on eating everything you grew first and then filling in with other healthy plant foods, you know, later. This will also save you guys more money. And also, you know, of course, a lot of the foods I promote you guys to grow and that you guys saw in this episode are some of the healthiest, highest ranked foods. So Dr. Jeff, what would you say are some of the healthier foods that people grow in their gardens that they might want to consider? Because some people just, I'm just going to grow tomatoes because I like tomatoes. But, you know, I know, I'm sure you know also, there are some foods that are a lot more valuable to eat and that we should be eating more of than others. So what would you say as some of the ones that you would recommend people grow?
Sure. Well, I think both of us are fans of Dr. Joel Fuhrman, and he likes to say G-bombs, which is a way to remember really healthy foods and a lot of these that we can grow ourselves. So G for greens, and you can get, you know, even in kind of regardless of where you live in America, you can either grow greens outside or you can grow greens inside. Microgreens on your windowsill during the winter, we do some of that as well. So think about greens. Berries. We love coming out and picking blueberries, raspberries, blackberries, and also some berries that you'll never see in a store maybe. So some, you know, if we're lucky, we might get some gooseberries or some currants, things that you don't see so often at the local grocery store. For all the onion family, the alliums. So, you know, onions, garlic, you put them in the ground and you kind of can forget about them. They're not very hard to grow crops, and they have so many beneficial nutrients in them. Mushrooms, my wife does the mushrooms. She gets kits typically and grows them inside, but we're also working on trying to get things like King's Trophoria wine cap mushrooms to grow outside. And then the last B is for beans. You can buy beans in bulk, which is an inexpensive way to do it, but you can also grow some of your own beans. And then the last S is for seeds. And so if you're growing pumpkins, you got pumpkin seeds. If you're growing sunflowers, you can have sunflower seeds. Also healthy seeds like flax and chia and hemp seeds are out there as well. We just haven't tried growing those yet.
And of course you could eat like onion seeds, you know, coriander seeds, which is cilantro seeds. A lot of the seeds, I mean, I eat my fennel seeds. A lot of the seeds you would use maybe as spices. Not, you know, you could eat mustard seeds. Actually, mustard seeds are a very good source of enzymes if you are cooking your kale to add to, you know, ground up mustard seeds. So, Dr. Jeff, I know you're into like blue zones and the different blue zones, and they've identified areas of the world. Actually, I have the blue zone ebook or audiobook on my phone I was listening to the other day, actually. There's blue zones around the world where they identified the longest lived peoples on the planet. And they have a certain kind of lifestyle and, more importantly, diet. So, Dr. Jeff, you want to share with my viewers their lifestyle and diet and how we can implement these as just Americans or people living in a, you know, not in these blue zones?
Yeah. I love Dan Buettner's work with the blue zones. And if you haven't, check out his books, check out his social media. But, you know, I like the idea that 80% of longevity is based off a lifestyle. 20% might be genes, and I'm not from a blue zone, so I don't share these genes with them, but we can share a lot of the same lifestyle practices. So what do they do? One thing that they have in common is that they tend to garden. They tend to grow their own food. And so that's one thing that we can all do here in those who are watching this video today. You get outside, you're having natural movement. You know, you don't have to own a spandex suit and a membership to the gym. But if you're getting outside, if you're, you gotta go and you gotta plant your plants, you gotta water your plants, you gotta harvest your plants, you gotta go out sometimes in the middle of the night to pluck the slugs off of your plants. These are all things that are keeping you moving naturally. And this ties into things like parking far away from the entrance to the grocery store, things like that. You want natural movement to be part of it. Their diet, 90% of their diet, like we mentioned earlier, is plant-based. Dan calls it a plant slant to your diet. So, you know, eat 100% plant-based if you want, but if that sounds too radical for you, eat as close to that as you can. And so we, you know, movement, the gardening, the diet, having community, having love, taking time to relax and to de-stress. And whether that is at the end of the day, looking out and saying, looking at the fruits of your labor for your hard work, whether it's sitting down with friends and having a good laugh and enjoying a good meal with some of the things that you picked out of your own garden today. Like this is the stuff of life. And this is going to help us not only live to 80, 90, and 100, but to be healthy when we get there and to be living in our own house, under our own roof, or with our own families instead of perhaps in a retirement home or in a place to where I'm just kind of, you know, in the fetal position in my own bed. And I know that's a possibility for me, but I love the idea of living in a way that's gonna make that a lot less likely.
So I know some of you guys out there wanna make some changes today because you haven't maybe been living the best lifestyle. You might be on blood pressure medication. You might be on different kind of medications. You're like, this doctor's guy, Dr. Jeff says you could maybe get off those things and I wanna get help, but my current physician doesn't do that for me. And I know you're part of this group, plant-based telehealth. You got the jacket on. And so, Dr. Jeff, if people live in certain areas, or maybe even if they live local to you, you could go out to their house. But most people in some certain, you know, states, you could actually do telehealth. So like coach them and be their literally their virtual doctor online to help them wean off their meds, to help them grow more food, maybe even give them some gardening tips to help them eat more plants and turn their health around through more natural, should I dare say natural methods when we're connecting it to a medical doctor. So you want to explain more about how that works and how you can help people in certain states?
Thanks, John. So first off, talk to your doctor about it, because he or she might already be thinking along these lines, but maybe didn't breach it with you because they didn't think that you'd be interested in it. So talk with your doc, and even maybe they're not already versed in it. Maybe they're not a lifestyle medicine physician, but they said, hey, I've been meaning to watch Forks Over Knives or The Game Changers or Fed Up or a lot of these movies that are out there that, you know, you might have a positive influence on your own doctor and get them motivated. But in addition to that, if you, you know, want to reach out to a doctor who is primarily focused on using lifestyle to help prevent, treat, and reverse, you can check out our place, which is Plant-Based Telehealth. We've got a group of 9 great docs that are licensed in all 50 states, and we can also see you if you live internationally as well. Personally, I am licensed in California, Texas, and in Florida. So I can do visits with folks that are in those states at the time of the call. But like I said, we've got great docs who can cover all 50 states. And lifestyle medicine is growing. You know, if you don't want to do telehealth and you want to see a local doc that does telehealth, I mean, that does lifestyle medicine, look up lifestyle medicine in whatever town you're in and see what's out there. And just try to get a different perspective on the same conditions that docs are all around the United States are treating every day.
Wonderful. So if you had to, I could say prescribe anything, but if you had to recommend something to all my viewers today to, you know, turn their health around, at least take a first step to turn their health around, what would you tell everybody?
Well, the title says it all. You got to be growing your own greens. And when you grow your greens and when you follow the stuff that John's telling us about, and I'm a fan of his videos, I watch his stuff, of course, when you follow his advice, you're going to be doing a lot of things, moving the right direction to getting healthy. And if you're already healthy, to staying healthy. And so get out there, grow lots of greens, grow lots of other things, try to keep things growing year round. We've got a bunch of small fruit trees so that we can be picking stuff almost every month. And part of that's our climate, I agree, but part of it is choosing the right things that work for you. So that you've just got nature's best medicine that you can bring in from, you know, 10 yards away into your house 3 times a day.
Wonderful, great tip. So Dr. Jeff, if anyone wants to link up with you or get a hold of you, how can they do that?
All right. So so the website is www.plantbasedtelehealth.com. I'm on social media. I do Instagram. I'm kind of new at it, so you know, take it with a grain of salt. But I'm at Dr. Jeff Pierce, and that's P-I-E-R-C-E. It's probably the best two ways.
All right. Wonderful. I'll put links down below to the Plant-Based Telehealth and his Instagram. And actually, that's how I got a hold of Dr. Jeff today. So Dr. Jeff, once again, thanks for having me out. I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. If you guys want more episodes with Dr. Jeff, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up, and also please be sure to share this with others out there so they can learn more about how a doctor would literally tell you guys to grow your own food and eat more plants, because it's one of the healthiest things you could do. And I mean, that's why I grow my food. Actually, I almost lost my life here in the same city that I'm sitting with you guys today many, many, many years later. And that's what I had to learn and adopt on my own, you know, for my own lifestyle. And that's what I share and why I'm passionate about sharing this message on YouTube with you guys. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below because you never know where I'll share up what we'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. They come out every 5 to 7 days. And more importantly, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,500 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel dedicated and going in depth on how to grow your own healthiest food on the entire planet at your own property at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.